Tonight's interrupted a little bit, but we'll get back to it for the last message, hopefully tonight in this series, about the battle rages. And tonight I would say that the spiritual battle rages. And I do not wish to belabor the point, but it is important for us, I think, to understand that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or fleshly. Now, this comes from 2 Corinthians chapter number 10, to which I invite your attention in the Bible, please. In 2 Corinthians chapter number 10 and verse number 3, here's what the Bible says. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And I always like to add verse number 5 with it after the parenthetical statement of verse number 4. There the Bible says, casting down imaginations, which brings to our ideas the thoughts of the playground of the mind, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. And notice now the importance in this spiritual warfare that we wage, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now, the idea of spiritual warfare is also brought to our attention in Ephesians chapter number 6, where the Bible says in verse number 10, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And certainly, we should take a look, I think, then at another verse which we have not heretofore in these lessons looked at, and that is John, please, chapter number 18. And I would like to, if I may, begin my reading in verse number 33. Then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again and called Jesus and said unto him, art thou the king of the Jews? Jesus answered him, sayest thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it thee of me? Of course, we have a real problem in Christianity of many times people just going along with the crowd. Even in our churches, brothers and sisters, the Bible talks about every man being fully persuaded in his own mind. And if there's one thing you need to be fully persuaded about, it's about the things of the Holy Bible, which involve the things of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now Pilate answered, am I a Jew? Thine own nation and the chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done? Jesus answered, now notice carefully, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered to the Jews. Of course, Peter had a lapse there for a little bit. Do you remember yonder in the garden? It's kind of a blessing to my heart in a way. I can't help it. I'm just that carnal or worldly or whatever you want to call it. But it does my heart good when I think of Peter drawing out his sword and cutting off Malchus' ear there. Of course, the Lord healed it. And as I've said before, I'll say again, had I been Malchus, I would have changed sides right then and there. I would have gotten away from that other crowd, and I'd have gotten in with the crowd that was following Jesus Christ in a vast way and in a fast hurry. Now, Jesus said, my kingdom, though, however, is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence. Pilate therefore said unto him, art thou a king then? Jesus answered, thou sayest that I am a king. Now, from Jesus' answer, we realize and understand that Pilate got the message on this thing. I personally believe that Pilate realized Jesus was who he said he was, but instead of converting to Jesus Christ and coming under his banner, Pilate took the basin, washed his hands, said, "I'm innocent of the blood of this just man." You don't just become innocent by washing your hands, brothers and sisters. It doesn't work that way. His wife had told him, "See, thou have nothing to do with that just man," and Pilate went ahead with it anyway and delivered him unto the Jews. Then he wanted to be free of it himself. It'll be on his hands for all eternity if he never came to Jesus Christ as a Savior. Back to what I was talking about, though, that Jesus answered in this vein, "Thou sayest that I am a king," shows us that, at least to me, I'm satisfied. Jesus is telling us, yes, Pilate, you're absolutely right in your assessment. I know that it's given in the form of a question, but you have to kind of understand a little bit about the Oriental way of saying things as opposed to the Occidental business. And I am convinced that Pilate, in his heart and his mind, felt like Jesus was who he said he was. That's why he tried to deliver him so much. Would to God he would have converted to Jesus Christ. But I never find that in the Bible. Now Jesus said, "Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice." Well, we see here, as my series title shows, that we're in a spiritual warfare. And I want to stress that, especially because of the day we live in when, take Islam, for instance. I mean, they're strapping bombs to themselves and they're blowing up people. They're terrorizing folks. Christianity is quite different. We are not to force people to convert to Jesus Christ. You cannot force anybody to convert to Christ anyway. A man's got to do it of his own free will, of the volition of his own will, must he come to our Lord and Savior. But we have in our world religions, obviously, that are out to, in a physical fashion, force it to be done. What do we need to remember? We need to remember that we're in a spiritual battle. We are in spiritual warfare. Now, before you get discouraged about not using the bombs and missiles and methods of this world, let me say this. The Bible does tell us, "Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." So just never you mind, when the dust is all settled, when it's all said and done, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords will be the one doing the reigning. Kind of like Job said this morning when I was preaching from that paragraph, and I shall see him for myself and not another. In my flesh I shall see God. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and on the earth shall stand, and I shall see him. Well, now, just never you mind. You have heard the statement to the effect that the weaponry of the pen is mightier than the sword. I'm sure you guys have heard that, if they still have school, anything like I had it when I was in school years and years ago. The pen is mightier than the sword. Well, let me just say this. The Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. And I believe, brothers and sisters, that indeed we need to realize that this spiritual battle we're in is not going to be fought with bombs and bullets and missiles. It's going to be fought with the Word of God and with the weapons at our disposal, spiritual weapons at our disposal. Now, lest you should misunderstand me, let me make a statement to this effect, please. I believe that there does come a time of war. Do I not speak the truth? I mean, hey, if you turn with me back to the book of Ecclesiastes, please, in the Old Testament, you're going to find this very truth in chapter number 3. And the Bible says, to everything there is a season. Now, this is Ecclesiastes back in the Old Testament, chapter number 3. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant, a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rend and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. And then he puts down as the last one, a time of war and a time of peace. And so it is that, yes, I believe there are times when war, a physical war, must come about. For instance, I am not for laying down and playing dead in this Islamic terrorism thing. I believe that we not only have a right, but an obligation to protect our people. Not that I desire to see others slain, not that I desire to see others in trauma, but I believe that there comes a time where reasoning is gone and we have to resort to some physical methods. I believe that has been shown throughout history. And in fact, this can be seen in the New Testament even. If you turn with me to Luke chapter number 22, please. And I will look at verse number 36. Again, that is Luke chapter number 22. And I'm going to start out in verse 31. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. Now that, brothers and sisters, is spiritual warfare. Let me read further. Jesus said, but I have prayed for thee, what a wonderful thing, that thy faith fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. And there's something that needs to be done in our churches. We need to try to be an encouragement, exhort one another to the honor and glory of Jesus Christ our Lord. There's somebody around you who's discouraged and down. Why don't you try to help build them up in the path of the Lord rather than kick them down further? Well, Jesus said, I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. And verse 33, Peter said to him, thinking a little bit more in the flesh, I said unto him, Lord, I am ready to go with thee both into prison and to death. And he said, now this is Jesus talking again, I tell thee, Peter, the cock shall not crow this day before thou, that thou shalt thrice deny that thou knowest me. And when he said unto them, when I sent you, and he said unto them, when I sent you without purse and scrip and shoes, lacked ye anything? And they said nothing. And you guys remember that in the Gospels, do you not? How that Jesus sent forth his disciples and he sent forth the 70. Don't take money with you or whatever. Go into whatsoever city, and if they receive you, let your blessing be upon it. If not, shake the dust off and go on to the next city. You remember that, I'm sure. I know that I'm not quoting it exactly. But now we have kind of the situation brought up to our attention. So again, if I may, please, in verse number 35, he said unto them, when I sent you without purse and scrip and shoes, lacked ye anything? And they said, nothing. Then said he unto them, but now, he that hath the purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip, and he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. I just want to bring that to your attention to try to state that I am not a pacifist. I am not for lying down and playing dead and letting anybody run over me. In fact, I need your prayers, brothers and sisters. I hadn't got the victory on that business of turning the other cheek yet. I think I probably got a lot of company here, is why I don't mind confessing that. But Jesus did say it, and it's something that we need to keep in mind. Here our Lord says, when I sent you forth without a sword, were you all right? Yes. All right. Now I'm telling you, you better understand that during this church age, there are going to be times when you're going to need a sword, if I may put it that way. There are going to be times when you're going to have to resort to that which you'd rather not do. There are going to be times when you would rather witness to the person and see them come to Christ as Savior, have their heart changed from that burning hatred against me to a love that is undeniable for me, the Lord Jesus is telling them. There are going to be times when you're going to need a sword. Now, I must confess that I don't like war. I think war is a terrible thing. I think lives are hurt in war. A lot of innocent people get involved in the drastic measures that war brings about. I don't like it, but sometimes I think that it does come to that. I feel a little bit like Ronald Reagan, who quoted Barry Goldwater, in case you're interested. The statement first came from him. He said, I'm not for war, but I'm for the power to prevent it. And I kind of have a feeling to that end myself. In this business of our spiritual battle that we're in, obviously, we need to realize that it's between, in an ultimate analysis, the devil and the Lord Jesus Christ. As I have tried to bring out at each one of these messages on Sunday night and the battle raging, Genesis 3:15, about the seed of the woman, which undeniably is Jesus Christ our Lord, made of a woman, made under the law, according to Galatians. The seed of the woman would bruise the serpent's seed's head, while the serpent's seed would bruise the seed of the woman's heel. Bruise the heel, it heals. Bruise the head, it is unto death. And our Lord conquered the devil, in one way of speaking, at Calvary when he died on the cross, and rose again the third day. Had Jesus not risen again that third day, there would have been no conquering of the devil whatsoever. But he not only died for our sins, shed his blood in atonement for our sins, but he rose as the victor the third day, to be our Savior. Hey, listen, he's got the power to deliver the goods that he promised to us, brothers and sisters. Job said, I know that my Redeemer liveth. Man, there is so much he was saying in that statement, I couldn't give it in 1,000 messages, I do not believe. Job said, I know that my Redeemer liveth, and he's going to stand on this earth and rule and reign. I am looking forward to that time. But until that time comes, I pray that the Lord may help me to be a good, and I'm going to use this phraseology now, and I hope you understand that it is in a spiritual vein, But I'm going to pray until that time comes for me to go to heaven, that I may be a good warrior for Jesus Christ. Now, when I say warrior, that doesn't mean that I'm going to go out here and don a couple of belts of bullets around my neck and gather guns together. Although, hey, I like shooting firearms. I did it one time. So that's how I know I like it. I think all that's interesting and neat and so on. But when I say warrior, I'm talking about being a spiritual warrior for Jesus Christ, my Lord. I'm talking about the kind of warrior that presents the gospel of salvation. I'm talking about the kind of warrior that gives witness to that Savior who said, "I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." I'm for being the kind of warrior who is able to get into the Word of God, study the Holy Bible, and be able to encourage somebody else's heart, soul, and mind in the way of Jesus Christ our Lord. That being the case, then, I think it is right for us to think just for a few moments, please, a little bit on our performance as a warrior for Jesus Christ. And I say I think this is important because in Romans, please, chapter number 7, the Apostle Paul had that famous paragraph, the things that he would not, he did, the things he would, he didn't do, and oh, wretched man that I am. Now, in verse number 18 of Romans chapter number 7, here's what the Bible says. "For I know that in me," the Apostle Paul said, "that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For look at it now. To will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not." Now, I'd like to suggest to you that when he used that phraseology, "to perform, I find not," we have not here a literal dead end, as it were. We have here the Apostle Paul giving us the beginning of finding the process of being able to perform. Do I not bring out a valid point? I mean, if not, we're hopeless. If we cannot perform for Jesus Christ in one way or another, well, what is the use? And so it's like this. While in my mind many times I myself say, how to perform, I find not. While I get disappointed in myself many, many times before the Lord, while I myself wish that I were better for the Lord, and I come to disappointment so many times, I believe that in the Word of God, God has given to us the tools for performing. Now, you may say, well, Brother Burkholder, you're contradicting the Apostle Paul. I don't think so in the language that I see his writing here. And in fact, in the very paragraph from which I'm quoting, he gives us one of the tools of doing for the Lord. One of those tools, at the end of it, he says, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me?" And then he gives the answer. I thank God through Jesus Christ my Lord. And then he gives in verse number 1 of chapter number 8, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." Right? Amen? Isn't that what we're talking about? The carnal versus the spiritual, or the flesh versus the spiritual. And so I'm saying that I think Paul is opening the door for us to, hey, you guys, if you'll think a little bit, if you'll do some spiritual exercises, you'll strengthen your spiritual muscles and you'll stand a better chance against the devil. Now, he is not telling us we're going to be 100% free of the devil's antics. He is not telling us you're going to be the victor over everything. He is warning us very carefully, I think, though, that if we will put into practice in our lives some of these things, we'll stand a better chance against the devil. Does that not make sense, brothers and sisters? Now, don't anybody get the idea you can find the magic wand to whip the devil in whatever you want to do. Be careful. Let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. And my time is fast running out, so I'm not going to have time to get into this, but it was done marvelously in the Sunday school class this morning. And that, listen, one of the weapons of our warfare is humility. Because did not Paul say in 2 Corinthians chapter number 12, when I am weak, then I am strong. He'd rather glory in his infirmities so that the power of Christ may rest upon him. Is that not the key? You want to win the battle? You're going to have the power of Christ. Now, that having been said, I'd like to give just a couple of things that I think might need to be reviewed quite often in Christianity to help people be up on the weapons of the warfare that God has given to us spiritually. You have to sharpen up your old physical weapons every once in a while, don't you? Like I have to get my weapon out once every 10 or 20 years and dust it off. And I better give it to Paul, I guess, to let him see if it still works or whatever. But, oh my word. Brother Burkholder, you mean to tell me you get your weapon out once every 10 or 20 years? Brother Burkholder, do you know where your weapon is? Yeah, I know where it is. Just give me a while to find it. If somebody comes into my house to rob me or something, I'm going to ask for a timeout. So I can find stuff and get ready with it there. I'll get Marsha with a big lampstand or something to conk them over the head in the process. But here now. Brother Burkholder, you 10 or 20 years. Oh, well, that's about like a lot of Christians on the spiritual weapons that God gives us to use. Well, now here, I must hurry and get this done so that we come to see some things. God has given us some tools at our disposal. The very first one is to be saved, genuinely born again. You want to get the victory? You're going to have to know Jesus Christ as your Savior. There's therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Now I grant you salvation. Hey, we're just a bunch of sinners saved by grace, right? And we fall more than we wish. Oh my goodness, we think to ourselves, Lord, will I ever get the victory? Well, one of these days you're going to get the victory. Let me just say this. Once you get in Christ, you're guaranteed the victory down the road somewhere. One of these days you're going to stand complete in Jesus Christ. One of these days you're going to have that glorified body. One of these days that sin process will all be gone. I know a lot of people think about going to heaven and think to themselves, well, I'll be glad. No more headaches, no more heartaches, no more bills to juggle, whatever you may want to talk about, monetary things and so on. You know one of the things I look forward to about going to heaven? No more propensity to sin. Amen. In fact, I guess if somebody were to ask me what I look forward to and get in heaven, I put down and see the Lord Jesus Christ, but my old sin nature be gone. I won't have any more of those kind of desires whatsoever. I grant you, while we're here, we're still in the flesh, but we get saved. I guarantee you the victory is ours in Jesus Christ. Praise God for that. But then there's also some stuff here that we can do that are going to help us out a little bit. Do I not speak the truth? For instance, get in the Bible. Study to show thyself a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Why? Because the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. piercing him to dividing asunder soul and spirit and the joints and the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. You must remember, please, that according to Ephesians chapter number 6, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is what? The Word of God. I tell you, brothers and sisters, God has not left us defenseless here at all. He has given us some tools that are quite worthy for us if we'll just make use of them, and one of them is the Bible. I would Christians spent as much time in the Bible as they did watching television. I would Christians would get as excited about talking concerning the things of the Lord as they do about whoever won the last Super Bowl. Boy, you know what presses a person's button? Listen to them talk for a while, and you can see where their heart is. We need to get in the Bible. You cannot get too much of the Bible. You say, "Oh, Brother Burkholder, you all the time having church. You, Brother Burkholder, you got a one-track mind. That's about all you can handle, I guess." Brother Burkholder, you think church ought to be going up there to the building and singing the songs of Zion and reading the Bible and having the preaching and teaching of the Word of God? You betcha. That's exactly what I think. Brother Burkholder, he wants to come Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, and then you want meetings throughout the year. You cannot get too much of the Bible. I not only want you to be in church, I want you to be in your Bible when you're home. That's why I try to get all of our people to sign up to read through the Bible once a year. You say, "I read it once." Oh, bless you. That's why I try to get people to read through the book of Proverbs once every month, every year. I get something new out of it every time I go through it. And let me tell you this also, I'm for reading the Bible. I'm just for getting in it and reading the Bible. But I also think Christians need to spend some quality time studying the Word of God on their own. In other words, don't see just how many chapters you can read. Try to see whether or not you're getting something out of it. Now, I know when you do that, you're going to say, "Well, boy, there's a lot I don't understand in there." Well, that's funny. I feel the same way. That's the way we are. Don't let it worry you. Your mind is not even close to the mind of God Almighty. The Bible was written by the infinite God. We should not even expect our poor little finite minds to get the thing done very well. But we can get some out of it, can we not? We can get something. And I encourage people, you need to study the Bible. I've told you before, let me give you this just real briefly. I was a budding theologian, and I thought to myself, you know, every theologian ought to read through the Bible cover to cover at least once so he could say he'd read through the Bible. I at least wanted that. I had enough sense at least to know I needed to read through the Bible. And I know you may say, "Well, yeah, you wanted to read it just so you could say you'd read it from cover to cover." Well, yeah, kind of. You're right about that. I admit my motives may not have always been pure, but hey, the Word of God is still quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged motive. And so I decided I'm going to read through the Bible. Now, I paid my way through college. They didn't have high-powered student loans back in those days, and I got out of college, I was debt-free and so on. But I worked. Marsha will remember a lot of times I'd write her letters and they'd be timed out at 3 in the morning and so on and so forth. And I worked my way through college. God blessed me immensely. I'm not griping about it. I'm thanking Him for it. I think I had it better than a lot of guys in today's college world, to tell you the truth. Yeah, I think it was better off back then. And I thought, though, now I've got to read through the Bible. Here I am. I'm going to be graduating with a degree in theology, and I've got to be able to say that I've read through the Bible from cover to cover. And that wasn't for my graduation. That was my own thinking that I had inside of me. And so I decided how much I was going to have to do in order to get through the Bible in the amount of time I had before I graduated. And I found after a while, I'd be so tired after doing my studies and doing my work and so on and so forth. I come home or back to the dorm at 2 and 3 in the morning and so on. I found that after a while my eyes were going across the pages, but it wasn't registering on my dull brain. And after a while of that, I got to thinking to myself, now David, you letting your mind go to sleep while your eyes are going across the pages and the phrases here. You need to come to grips with that. So I decided what I was going to do at the end of each chapter. I was going to stop and review and ask myself what I read. And if I couldn't tell myself what I read, I was going to go back and read the chapter again. And I was going to do that until I could tell you what I read. It was a disciplinary process in keeping my mind on what I was doing instead of letting the devil distract me. Listen, I finally got to the point where I was able to better keep my mind on the Bible. But I got to warn you, the devil is a sly old fox to this day. When I start to get into the Bible, everything in the world will happen to distract me from the... If the phone hasn't rung all day, all I need to do is open my Bible and start reading it. If the doorbell hasn't rung, all I need to do is get on the bed and start reading my Bible. And something will happen down the road somewhere. Well, what are you going to do? Stay in the Bible. Now, there are times when you have to stop and take care of stuff. For instance, when Marcia tells me she's just baked a lemon pie or something like that, I don't want to hurt her feelings by not having a piece of it. So I will make myself eat a piece of lemon pie. But you got to discipline your mind to stay in the Word. Now listen, there's not a one of us here who are as brilliant as we think we are. And you're going to have to discipline your mind to stay in the Bible. If you find yourself just having your eyes go across the phrases there, you stop right then and there. Pray, oh Lord, forgive me for letting my mind wander. Please defeat the devil as he tries to defeat me. And Lord, I'm going to start over and try. Would you please help me? You'd be surprised what good you can do out of it. Well, now I'm talking about the weapons of our warfare. Is not the Bible one of the weapons of our warfare? Oh, please keep this in mind. Sometimes people will say, where's my sword? And they mean their Bible. It's not your sword. One of the problems is too many times Christians try to use the Bible as their sword rather than letting the Holy Spirit of God use it as His sword. But cheer up, rejoice and be glad. He's still given us the holy, infallible, inspired Word of God. We still have the Bible. We have salvation. We have the Bible. Another thing we have, dear friends, and please, I know the time is up already, but please study Ephesians chapter number 6. Having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit. Then, you know, it gets in there about praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And then Paul said, and for me. Another weapon that God has given us is prayer. I believe that Christians are probably guilty to a great degree of not having the prayer life that we should have. God help us. I know it's easy to criticize others when we need to take a look at our own prayer life. I remember reading about Martin Luther one time. He said, "I am so busy that if I did not get up at 3 a.m. in the morning and spend 3 hours in prayer, I could not get everything done." Quite a statement. You know, brothers and sisters, God has promised to hear the prayer of His children. Now, it is true that your sin has separated between you and your God. So He says, you know, the breastplate of righteousness. But I think that we need to realize, dear friends, that God has given us the Bible and prayer. Now, kick in that breastplate of righteousness too. In other words, try to live right. Nobody's going to do it perfectly, but for crying out loud, try. Too many Christians think they've got a license to sin because they're saved by grace. God help us is all I've got to say. Now, we have salvation. We have the Bible. We have prayer. There's one other thing that I want to speak of tonight that I think God has given us as a tool to have sharpened up, a tool in our armory, as it were, as we are warriors for Jesus Christ, our glorious Savior, not warriors after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And this tool is the Church of Jesus Christ. Now, folks, Jesus established the church. I gotta admit, there are a lot of parachurch organizations that I think serve a good purpose. I'm not going to deny that. But Jesus established what? The church. The assembly. The coming together. And you say, "Oh, Brother Burkholder, you don't know how boring it is to listen to you preach all the time." Hey, I'm going to die one of these days. You won't have to do it all the time. Cheer up and be glad. One of these days, you're probably going to be saying, "Oh, I wish I could hear Brother Burkholder speak. Get one of my tapes back there, or get one off of the YouTube or something like that." It won't be me, really. I'll be rejoicing in heaven with the Lord. I want to tell you this. You need to be a part of a good, local, Bible-believing, New Testament church. You need the fellowship of other Christian brothers and sisters. You need the exhortation they're going to give you. You need the criticism they're going to give you once in a while. We don't like it, but we need it. We need the preaching of the Word of God. And I don't know how many of you noticed on Facebook. I think I just put it on there this afternoon, if I'm not mistaken. But something Leonard Ravenhill had to say about the need of an avalanche of conviction of sin in this day that we live in. Now, Jesus established the church. Upon this rock I'll build my church, and you know it, the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Right? That's what he had to say. I think that it's good for people to be a born-again, baptized believer and a member of a local New Testament church. I mean a local New Testament church, somewhere where somebody wonders where you are when you're not there. I mean somewhere where you try to serve the Lord in whatever capacity you can. And some people will say, "Well, Brother Burkholder, you don't have anything for me to do." God does. You like what, Brother Burkholder? Sit in the pew and sing the songs and listen to the Word. Let me say this to those folks who are concerned about having something to do. There's a part of me that many times think a lot of people want notoriety for themselves. You get into a good church and you go to that church long enough, you prove yourself to be dependable in that church, and you'll be tapped to do the work in that church. I've never seen too many workers in a church who are dependable. You get into church, you serve the Lord. I mean, even if it's you're coming in the back door and try to come in on time, I'm a great believer in that. Amen. Amen, Brother Burkholder, preach it. Thank you, brother, I will. You know, brothers and sisters, you get into church and you live for the Lord and you do like you ought to do, and God will raise you up a step or two as He sees fit. Yeah, well, Brother Burkholder, I've been going to this church all my life, and all I ever get to do is open the door for people that come in. Rejoice and be glad. King David, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God. Well, Brother Burkholder, I've been. Yeah, let me try to get you to be like John the Baptist was once more. John said, I must decrease. He must increase. I'm talking, brothers and sisters, along this vein, that we're in a spiritual battle. If you're not saved, get saved tonight is my plea. If you are saved, make sure you're keeping those tools that God has given us shiny and clean and serviceable and at your disposal and ready to use on a moment's notice. Because we're in the world, whether we like it or not. We're in the world. And you want to remember Jesus said, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil that is in the world. Now listen, we're in the world, and if I can borrow from Wednesday night just a moment or two, who knows? God has brought us to the kingdom for such a time as this. I wasn't born in the days of the Old West when Roy Rogers was riding Trigger through the hills back then. Those days are gone. I'm alive today. Am I going to be alive for Jesus Christ or be an old dead fish? I pray God will help every one of us understand. Yes, there is the dilemma of how to perform. But hey, listen, don't blame it all on God. He's given us the tools of performance. I am convinced of that. What we need to do is get with the program. Let's stand with our heads bowed and eyes closed. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for the time in thy house tonight. Now, Lord, if there's anybody here tonight who's not genuinely saved, I pray that tonight might be the night when they get saved. I pray, dear God Almighty, that those who are here and are saved might see indeed that you have given us some tools that are